We have a fantastic speaker this evening. He was formerly with MySQL AB since 2001, straight through the Sun Microsystems acquisition. Please welcome the co-founder and field CTO of MariaDB, Max Mieter.
Thank you. All right, so I inherited this presentation from Roger. As you can hear, I'm currently based in Atlanta. I'm from Georgia. Actually, no, I'm not from Georgia, but I am based in Atlanta. I'm from Finland, where our corporate headquarters is. And I'm going to talk tonight a bit about industry trends as we see them at MariaDB and kind of how it relates to, well, databases and MariaDB in general. I guess if you have questions, feel free to answer, ask them at any point in time, but we'll have a Q&A session after as well. And as Eric was saying, I used to work for a company called MySQL, which is kind of the basis of MariaDB. Actually, so who here has used or uses MariaDB? Should be a show of hands. Not that many. MySQL? Okay, awesome. Other databases? Okay, good. All right, that's actually pretty good. I'm wondering if I should do an intro of what MariaDB is before. I'll get to that, doesn't matter. So MariaDB is a fork of MySQL, basically. So you know, there's a historical link to that. But I'll get to that later. Which is also why I used to work, well, having worked for MySQL makes a lot of sense for MariaDB. But so I'm gonna start with a few industry trends, and this is gonna relate to NoSQL and kind of what we're doing at MariaDB, what we're foreseeing at MariaDB. So first of all, one thing we're seeing is that innovation is relentless and it's everywhere. So there's an increased, as you probably experienced in your lives, there's an increased, it looks like there's an increased innovation, increased amount of stuff coming out faster and faster. And it's actually been studied, and there's a lot of, there's a guy called Ray Kurzweil. Have you ever heard of him?
Yes.
Yeah. So he has the law of accelerating returns, which basically predicts or says that any kind of evolutionary system will have an exponential growth rate, right? So this would be both for technology or, I guess, human society as a whole. And there's a lot of proofs for this, well, in his books at least. Where you kind of see things, how technology or the human society is evolving faster and faster. The pace of evolution is going faster and faster. And there's a lot of anecdotal evidence that you can look at. For example, if you look at how quickly things change, so if you look 1,000 years back and you see, okay, what changed, how much change happened during 100 years, it's not a whole lot that changed 1,000 years ago. But if you look at the past 100 years, there's a lot more, right? So that's, at least we can be clear, we can agree that the pace of change is increasing. He actually predicts that there's a thing, there will be a thing called a singularity when it decreases so much that it will almost go straight up the curve, and you would basically have daily, like the paradigm shifts will be almost on a daily rate or hourly rate. But I'm not going to talk about that anymore than that. But, He predicts this to happen sometimes in the 2050s-ish, so if you're still alive then, it might be interesting times. But I'm not here to talk about that, because I'm going to talk about how this relates to kind of the technology industry and the database industry itself. But some kind of evidence of the fact that innovation and the pace of evolution is growing faster and faster. So here is basically different types of inventions and how quickly they become used by, in this case, the US population. This is a quarter of the US population. So how quickly a quarter of the US population started using this telephone, radio, and television, and so forth. This is, by the way, a logarithmic scale. So if this line is straight, then it's exponential. And this line is actually not straight. It goes faster and faster. So it's actually faster than exponential. And well, you see mobile phones here when they came out and how quickly they started, they were being used, but another anecdotal example would be something like the iPhone or mobile phones without keyboards. The first mobile phone without a keyboard came out in 2007 or 8, was the iPhone. I mean, who here has a mobile phone with a keyboard? Two guys, right? So in 10 years, pretty much everyone has a mobile phone. There's like three billion mobile phones in use daily, and none of them have keyboards. So pretty quickly, half the population is using these mobile phones. All right, so what does that have to do with databases? Well, not a whole lot, actually. So I'm going to something that has more to do with databases. So you guys all know about Moore's Law, right? Which basically was about how fast, I guess, how CPUs with every 24 months, CPUs will double in speed. And technically, Moore's Law kind of died when they couldn't put more in one core, they couldn't add more CPU cycles. But if you expand Moore's Law into something different, like here it's calculations per second, well, per $1,000, and you go back in time and kind of to present day, it actually brings a fairly nice logarithmic linear curve as well. So this goes all the way from electromechanical devices, so like calculation with like, well, you know, whatever they used back then. So here too, you have kind of a logarithmic scale. And another, to get even closer to what we're actually talking about here, let's look at storage. So back in the 90s, this is actually the price for one gig of storage. So if you go back to the 1980s, you had to pay $1 million for a gig of RAM. And actually, well, back in those days, there was a guy called Bill Gates. Have you heard of Bill Gates? Who famously said, I don't know if this is true or not, but he famously said that no one is ever going to need more than 640K RAM. Yeah. It's a well-known quote, but I couldn't find any validation for this, but everyone knows about this, right? Anyway, so you have to pay $1 million for a gig of RAM or storage. Today, you have to pay 15 cents for a gig. So the innovation in storage has, well, been pretty rapid. Again, this is a logarithmic scale, so the price has also gone down on an exponential level. And well, what does this mean? It means that basically if you have something where you use storage, when you have an increasingly rapid, let's say, availability of storage, you have to also have a software that's able to use this storage. So for example, in MariaDB, in the latest version of MariaDB in 10.2, we added VoxDB, which was one of the trivia questions, as storage, which is a storage engine that's optimized for SSDs. Because SSDs will probably never be cheaper than spinning disk, well, not soon, but SSDs are kind of the way to go because they're much faster they're much faster. And of course, SSDs have their own different demands, right? So you can't, if you optimize something for using spinning disks as storage, you can't do the same optimization for SSDs because they have SSDs have other issues like how lifetime of an SSD disk and so forth. Which is why Myrox comes as a different storage engine in MariaDB because it's actually optimized for SSDs in the sense that it has a much higher compression algorithm, you know, in order to use less storage because SSDs are more expensive. But it also writes a lot less to disk than what we use for our traditional storage engine. Because again, SSDs have a lifetime which is completely linearly dependent on how much you write on them, which is not true for spinning RAW disks or spinning RAW. that's something that where MariaDB is very well suited, because we have this storage engine API. I'll get to MariaDB how it's MariaDB architecture later. But we have a storage engine API which allows you to just add new storage engines. So when you have new storage coming up, new types of storage where you have to change the way you write stuff to disk, well, you can write a new storage engine. Well, someone who needs this can. In this case, it was mainly Facebook who was behind the MyRocks storage engine. For those who are interested, so MyRocks is based on RocksDB, which is based on LevelDB, which was originally Google, I think. Does anyone know?
Yes.
Yes. It was originally developed by Google, and then Facebook took it over, and Amazon at some point. But anyway, it's a long story of things that were forked and changed and so forth. And now at Facebook, they store quite a bit of data, right? So for them, being able to increase their, say, lifetime of their SSDs has a huge impact on their bottom line. Right. So being able to compress storage better is something that for a smaller company with smaller, let's say, storage, it's not a problem yet, because you don't store as much data. But for Facebook, because of the quantity of data they store, it's a huge problem. There's a huge benefit in this. But this is something that benefits everyone else afterwards. All right, so here we have a storage engine optimized for SSDs. Basically, are we done? Well, of course not, because the storage innovation keeps advancing faster and faster. For example, Intel is working on these 3D XPoint cards, which I don't even know if they're out yet for general usage. But it's basically persistent RAM, which with microsecond response time. I don't think they're out yet, but they're like 64 gigs per card and so forth. So there's already the next generation of storage, and someone has to create a new storage engine for this as well. And this is kind of where MariaDB architecture fits in so well, because of the storage engine API that allows you to just add storage engines. You don't have to change your whole server. You just write a new storage engine, and you have the option of using this. For more, say, traditional databases or products, they might be more tied into what the underlying storage layer was all the way throughout the product. So it's not easy to just change with SSDs. So that's one of the geniuses with MariaDB that we have this storage in an API, which was kind of happened by mistake, but that's a different story. Then the second part of computers besides storage is, of course, processing. I already alluded to this with Moore's law, but the big change now or lately, after say 2005, when we kind of reached the limit of how much cycles you can get into a single core, instead we start expanding by adding more and more cores to a single chip. So I think in 2006 you could get like a 4-core chip. That was about the max. And now you can get 20 to 64 cores on a chip. And well, this is gonna soon expand as well. So again, in order to take advantage of this, you need to have an architecture that's able to utilize all of these cores. So if you have software that relies heavily on having a monolithic process that relies on having a lot of memory available to this process and so forth, you're not going to do well when someone comes with a 128-core chip. So you need to have architecture that's heavily multi-threaded. And then another trend that we're seeing back in the beginning of 2000s, there used to be a lot of, or people were having issues, their workload could not fit on a single server. So this graph kind of shows the workload you needed compared to how much you could fit, how much capacity a single server had. Right. So back in the 2000s, the workload you needed to put on a single server was far beyond what you could actually fit on a server. So the only way to get around this was to do some kind of scale. So you needed to distribute your workload on multiple servers, potentially do sharding or read scaling and so forth. And obviously, MariaDB existed back then as MySQL, so we have things like replication for read scaling, and we have the sharding engine, which is called what? It was one of the trivia questions.
Spider.
Someone was awake. Yes, we have a sharding engine called Spider for write scaling. But now we kind of getting to a point where we have not unlimited server capacity, but you can spin up. You can go to Amazon, you can get a server with 4 terabytes of RAM and pretty much infinite storage and 128 cores or 256 cores. I don't even know what the limit is anymore in Amazon. But you can get a pretty heavy server on demand, pretty much, from Amazon. So it's kind of the trend is kind of going back again to, instead of scaling out to horizontal scaling, to doing vertical scaling, because you can actually have huge servers again. You can fit most of your workloads on a single server. And that's going to have an impact also on your needs for the database, because obviously one of the issues when you start scaling out the database has to do with consistency. Right, as soon as you have multiple servers, you need them to be somehow synchronized, consistent, or you don't. And that's a question of whether consistency is important or not. And I'll get back to that later. There's also been a lot of innovation in software architectures. We've gone from a kind of a client server model where you have this huge server and then have clients performing requests to the server. There's the cloud, where you have multiple virtual servers, and now to microservices. And that also has an impact on the platforms. So usually before, everything would be on-premise. You would have all your servers on-premise. You had a data center, you have a guy, if you wanted a server, you had to fill in a request form, you had a guy, it would take a couple of months, and then you get your server and so forth. And today, that's way too slow. So the first part was having cloud or having hybrid between on-premise and cloud. And now the next step is containers, where you can kind of run your own stuff anywhere. And of course, MariaDB works on all of these. We have obviously on-premise, we're the default in most Linux systems. So kind of any Linux that you run, Debian, Red Hat, SUSE, the default database to install would be MariaDB. But also on the cloud, we have AMIs for AWS, we have whatever they're called in Azure and so forth. I guess containers are still pretty new, so in containers, it's a bit more complicated, partly because one of the benefits of containers is being stateless, or the features, and it's kind of problematic for a database to be stateless. Typically, the purpose of a database is to store a state. So, in order to make databases work well with containers, you have to externalize storage, and in some form. That's kind of still in its infancy, so there's not a lot of solutions for how to externalize storage yet. But it's coming, and very soon you will have external storage with containers. But we're also working on working with containers. For example, we're working with Docker to have MariaDB images provided by us on Docker Store and so forth. So we're kind of trying to be in all of these places as they happen. We talked to a lot of enterprises who are moving in this direction. They're asking us, all right, so we want to create our own database as service clouds. How do we do that, right? And there's a lot of possible solutions and hybrid using containers and so forth. Anyway, we're there looking at this. All right, so then if you look at the data life cycle. So typically you will have someone, your boss or someone, ask you, hey, we need a new application. on Monday, and you're like, all right, you start writing an application. You need to store all the data somewhere, so you kind of have a database. You store your transactions there. It becomes very much OLTP-like, right? You store just transactions. Someone buys something, let's say you have some kind of store or something to sell stuff. You know, you store the transactions in a database. And then after a while, this application becomes more important. And, well, the manager starts asking questions, all right, so how much did we sell last month compared to the previous month, and so forth. So you need to perform analytics on the data as well. It's not enough to just store the transactions. You need to be able to perform historical analysis on the data. And you enter into OLAP. And that's something where we've been working on lately a lot by adding something called Column Store, which is a columnar engine from ADB, so you can perform analytics on historical data as well. And there are kind of other intermediate versions of data as well. For example, like temporal data, we have something coming up in 10.3 where you can store or basically all the versions of a row are stored in a database. You can actually query the database and see, all right, how did this row look 5 months ago? But I'll get into that more as well. And as your data grows, your OLTP data grows, you will start needing more and more data. But as you have the cloud and you kind of have the mainframe on demand, or you can basically just increase your machine or the machines you have by using Amazon or whatever, instead of having to scale out. So you start with a small application, OLTP. You start storing more and more data. You start having needs for analytical queries. You want to be able to do all this as seamlessly as possible, right? So one solution would be to start distributing data across multiple machines. But the problem is that when you do that, you run into issues with consistency and other things. And as soon as you start dealing with things like eventual consistency and things like that, your application has to be aware of this, right? So your application has to know that, hey, the data I'm reading might not be the latest data if you go into eventual consistency. So you kind of, and it's not a, you know, typically for developers it seems like a, well, whatever, it doesn't matter, but there are often quite hefty ramifications of this. So your application definitely has to be aware of the data. So instead of distributing your data on multiple machines and multiple cores, most use cases, most workloads will actually fit on a single machine. As we are 256 cores and 4 terabytes of memory, which is, I think, the largest you can get on Amazon right now. There's not a lot of workloads that wouldn't fit on this machine. So, kind of, I guess the point is kind of that distributing your data or sharding across multiple machines is no longer necessary in most cases. Obviously, there are always cases where it will be necessary, but in most cases, you don't actually need this. You can have a machine big enough to support this. So we're kind of, again, going away from horizontal scaling to vertical scaling. And with cloud, it becomes kind of seamless to do so. You can start small and just expand your virtual machine as you go. And I think consistency is something that's kind of been a bit overlooked, especially with the NoSQL, with eventual consistency. I guess if you look back further in time, you used to have these monolithic huge transactions that would take a long time. And as soon as you distributed something, you would use some complicated protocol like a two-phase commit or something that would take a lot of time and send things back and forth. Does anyone here know a product called MySQL Cluster? No one. Okay. Good. I won't mention it then. It's a product we had at MySQL, which was one of the worst named products in the history of product naming, I guess, because everyone thought it was a cluster of MySQL servers, but it wasn't. It was actually a sharded distributed storage behind a MySQL server. And we had a lot of issues because of the name or people's expectations, but the point is that that was an engine that did a two-phase commit protocol behind the scenes. So you did a transaction, it would basically take multiple nodes and do a two-phase commit protocol. Every time you did any kind of write query, it would basically send this to multiple nodes to make sure that it was first there was a prepare phase, make sure that everything was prepared, and then the commit phase where it did everything. And this added a lot of latency to your transactions, because every transaction, every operation has to go through this cycle of sending it back and forth. So that's why it didn't work very well, typically. So then you had NoSQL came in and said, well, if you don't, we don't care about consistency, just it will eventually propagate. Mm-hmm. So it's eventually consistent. But that has its own drawbacks, right? Because you don't know when it's going to be consistent, you don't know how old this data is, if it's new and so forth. So you have to, as I said, you have to design your application to not care about or be aware of the fact that this might be old data, it might not be old data, you don't know. So I think consistency does matter and to a lot of transactions. So we're kind of moving to a model where you're having microservices and you're having smaller parts of your application. Your application is becoming divided into smaller parts, and you need consistency within this part of your application, whereas you don't have to have a consistency over the whole monolithic thing, because it's no longer monolithic, it's split into smaller pieces. But you will still need consistency in these microservices. So then if you look at use cases overall for databases, basically there's always the extremes. So for example, there are some edge cases where you just have very, very simple transactional key value lookups, and you don't ever do anything else. For example, some kind of some logging of some operation, some manufacturing thing where you just log stuff and you just look up specific events and nothing else. And here, NoSQL definitely could be a key value store could definitely be the solution. But because it provides a lot of performance, you might have huge amounts of data. But you, of course, can't do much analytics typically with most of the NoSQL databases. Or you couldn't. They're kind of moving towards SQL. Then you get into the OLTP transactional space, where you do transactions, say, you have a web store or a bank or something where you need to have ACID properties of a database. You need to make sure that if a transaction takes place, it actually takes place all over the place. You can't have stuff taken out of your inventory but not sold or something like that. Take money being transferred from one account but not actually added to the other and so forth. So this kind of tries to display, okay, the going from a pure OLTP, is a pure key value lookup, to this very large analysis of data and here in the middle of the code, you have the amount of use cases you have of all of these. So the typical OLTP and transactional is a large part, and then we start moving into things like temporal analysis, where you still want to have a structure of tables, and you have structured data, and you have OLAP, where you do analytical queries on your data. And then the last piece would be kind of unstructured data, where you have analysis on unstructured data. And I guess the point here with this slide is that the relational databases fits the majority of the use cases. So you have the extreme unstructured data use case here on the OLAP edge, where you can't really use relational databases. And then you have the extreme key value lookup on the other edge, where you could use relational databases, but the key value store would just be more performant than that. But as again, coming back to my previous slide about the fact that you can kind of get a huge machine on demand. So as the kind of the limits of a machine are kind of disappearing, the relational database kind of piece of this is expanding as well, both for data size and speed. But again, you need to have, of course, a relational database that's able to use all of this hardware that you have available. So if you have 256 cores, but your database is kind of designed to have a main process that does most of the processing, it doesn't help you very much. So based on this, what kind of, I have some future predictions here about the database market, but kind of based on what I just said. So the first prediction is that the relational databases will reconquer the database market. This is kind of happening already in a sense. Like NoSQL was huge 5 years ago and 7 years ago, and we kind of see a lot of the players are falling out, and we kind of see a convergence towards some NoSQL databases, but also back towards relational. And this is partly because of the hardware, partly because of the consistency. And many of the NoSQL databases have noticed this as well. As you probably know, many of them are actually creating SQL or SQL-like APIs for their databases, right? So they're kind of, they are going back to relational as well, even though the storage, it doesn't change the storage. The second prediction is that consistency across machines will be commoditized, because I think this will be increasingly important partially because of NoSQL having done dimensional consistency. I guess as an industry we've noticed the kind of the weaknesses of not having consistency, so I think this will be increasingly demanded, and we've seen it, and there will be more and more solutions to have consistency across machines because it's needed as well. All right, so that was kind of very general. I had a few things on MariaDB. So let's look a bit closer at MariaDB. So basically at MariaDB, this is kind of what I just said, is kind of the trends we're seeing, and we're trying to take all this into account when we're kind of designing the future of MariaDB. But MariaDB is a bit different than a lot of products in the sense that MariaDB is open source, right? Which means that there's a company, MariaDB, I guess it's called AB, it's a Finnish company originally, but we don't develop everything that goes into MariaDB. It's also an open source project. So we get contributions from left and right. We don't take our top engineers, put them in a room somewhere in Finland, or in a hut somewhere in Finland under the snow, and say, all right guys, come out when you have a plan for the next 10 years of MariaDB. We have guys who try to do that, but at the same time we have customers who come to us and they say they want to do this and they want to do that. But we also have a community, a developer community. So we have companies like Google who say, we really need a data addressed encryption, so we coded it here. Can you please add this to MariaDB? And I mean, we kind of did. We have Facebook who said, well, we need to be able to use SSDs efficiently. So we've kind of adapted RocksDB. We created RocksDB to work really well with SSDs. We would like this to be integrated into MariaDB as a storage engine, and we did that. We have Alibaba who's developing MariaDB as a database as a service internally. So they've done a lot of optimizations for running multiple MariaDB servers in the same infrastructure, and they've added a lot of code to MariaDB for that. So basically, we have all these different organizations, different people who kind of have demands and ideas that we didn't think of because we just didn't, because we're just 20, whatever, 50, 50 engineers thinking about our, with our narrow vision, but we have all these customers who have come up with innovative ideas, and because it's open source, we can actually take advantage of this, right? So that's a huge benefit of migrating over, well, at least proprietary databases, right? How am I on time, by the way?
You're fine.
I'll just continue. So, a few words about the product. So, I mean, most of the time when I speak about MariaDB, I talk about the MariaDB server, but we actually officially have like three official products at the moment. We have the MariaDB server, which I'll talk more about that in a minute, about the architecture behind it. But we also have, as I mentioned, something called MariaDB Column Store, which is a column storage engine, right? So it's typically, who knows what columnar storage engine is, or columnar storage? Raise your hands. Okay, a couple. So columnar storage is something that's designed for analytics by storing, typically in a database, you store things in rows, right? You have rows in the database, which means that, you know, typically in order to find specific values, you have to look through all of the rows to get a specific column in a row, which is great for certain things. But when you start doing heavy analytics, you typically want to do an analysis on a specific column instead of the whole row. So you don't need everything in a row. You just need a specific column. For example, if you want to calculate the average sales price per month or something, average deal size per month or something, you only need to know what the price was. You don't need all the other columns. And so in order to do these kinds of types of analytics faster, you store data in columns instead of storing the whole row together. Every column has its own storage. So basically in our column store, there will be one file per column. Okay, it's more complicated because there's speed up and so forth, but basically each, you have like the column value stored in the same place. And to make this faster, we have optimizations there, then like things like, basically they're stored at 8 megabyte extents. So you basically have 8 million bytes of the same, and basically we keep track, okay, what's the minimum value, the maximum value, average, and stuff like that. So you have overhead for each of these extents. So you can do quick calculations without having to read every single value and things like that. So again, this is great for analytics. Why isn't everything stored like this? Well, because if you do a lot of writes, it's not so fast. Because now if I insert a row, I have to go and insert values in all of these different files for the columns. If I update, I have to go and look up, okay, where is this row and so forth. So column stores are great for analyzing large amounts of data, but they're not so great for write heavy operations. That's why we need a separate, that's why typically we have separate products for this. Now, at MariaDB, our goal or end goal is that column store is just going to be a storage engine. So basically, you'll be able to, in the same MariaDB server, you can have OLTP stored in traditional engines, you can have SSD optimized storage with RocksDB or MyRox, and you're going to be able to have OLAP usage in column store. This is not the case completely yet, it's still a separate product, but in the MariaDB column store, it looks like a MariaDB server. You can use our other storage engine in there, but you don't have column store with the standard server. But that's something we're kind of working at convergence. We want to have a MariaDB framework where you can choose based on what kind of storage you have, what kind of use case you have. You can basically change how you store the data. And then the third product we have separate is called MariaDB MaxScale. That was also one of the trivia questions. And this is basically a database proxy it does a lot of things, to simplify it, it basically transparently hides complicated database hierarchy. So if you have, say you have master slave, you have for read scalability, you have a master, you have slaves and things like that. You don't want your application to have to be aware of, hey, what if a slave drops down? What if I suddenly need 7 servers instead of 3 and so forth? So you have max scale in front, and then max scale is aware of the changes you have in your database topology, and your application doesn't have to worry about it. And that also allows you to do things on a security level. If all your queries pass through max scale, you can do things like intercept the queries, and we have blacklisting features and whitelisting and so forth, adding to your security requirements. If you look a bit closer at the MariaDB server, the architecture in it, I don't know if you can see this in the back, but there's a couple of things in this slide that are good. So first of all, we kind of showcase the fact that we have a lot of innovation that happens outside MariaDB. So everything that's green is actually being contributed by someone outside of the corporation. So we have different storage engines being contributed by outsiders, but also parts of integral parts of the MariaDB server of the kernel. For example, there's a feature called multi-social application, which allows a slave to have multiple masters, and this feature was originally contributed by Taobao, a Chinese company. And at the same time, this slide shows you a bit of the architecture, where the main kind of feature, or the main unique feature of MariaDB is the fact that we have the storage engine API, so that the storage layer, there's an API between optimizing the storage layer, and you can create new storage engines which are optimized for new types of storage without having to interfere with the server. And here we have RocksDB being one, column store being one, our sharding engine, Spider, being one. So basically you can just, on a table level, you can choose the storage you want based on all of these. Like there's a memory engine, which basically stores stuff in memory only, and things like that. So I already mentioned this, the fact that we have a community, of a developer community, we get contributions from different companies, and it is unique in a way, especially for databases. There's not that many other databases that have this opportunity. Even MySQL. I mean, I used to work for MySQL, and we never got contributions in this form. Maybe it was too early. Maybe it had to do with other things. But MariaDB has a huge developer community where we get contributions from a large set of different companies that are doing. Some of them are just individuals who are coding features. Some of them are companies like Google or Facebook that have needs. But we have a large. I guess the benefit is that, you know, our talent pool or our development department is so much bigger than our company, because anyone can contribute. I mean, obviously not anyone. You have to dig down in the code and know the code to be able to contribute, but technically anyone could do it. So that's the benefit of being open source. And MariaDB doesn't. MariaDB is GPL licensed, and we at MySQL we actually used to have a dual license option. So we had the server, MySQL server, was GPL. But we could also sell a commercial license version, because we own all of the copyright of everything. So we could actually sell different licenses. And Oracle has further expanded this, because they have some features that are only available in MySQL Enterprise Edition. Right? So they have some features you can only get in the Enterprise Edition, and the Enterprise Edition is only sold as a commercial license. Which means that if you want to use the open source version, the GPL version, you don't get all the features. We don't do this. We actually can't even do this if we wanted to, because we don't own all the copyright. So we have no choice. Basically everything we do in the server is GPL and open source. And it's pretty great to have this community of innovation. So then a few specifics on where we're going and what we're doing. So our latest release of MariaDB is called 10.2, our latest GA version. Here's, a long list of stuff we've added to 10.2. I'm just gonna name a few of these things, but a couple of things we've been working on a lot lately has been security features, because we have more and more enterprise customers. So that's also a thing that's been a big shift in the industry in general. Back in the days when I started at MySQL, we used to go into banks and other companies, hey, you should use MySQL. They were like, yeah, it's open source, we can't touch it. Now banks are calling us, hey, we need an open source database. So there's been a huge shift in mentality, I guess, or there's actually an open source mandate now in companies. It has to do with multiple things. Partially, it has to do with cost, because proprietary software is often more expensive. And another thing which is related is the vendor locking. If you start using a proprietary database, and you have everything you own in your proprietary database, and 2 years later they say, well, we're gonna quadruple our prices. And if you don't, if you don't pay, you have to uninstall. And you're like, but everything I have relies on this, and it's a huge project to get it out. So having an open source database, there is a vendor, people pay us, but it's GPL. We can never say uninstall, because it's GPL software. You can run GPL software as much as you want. So we cannot force people to uninstall. We cannot do auditing and things like that. So there's no vendor locking by using MariaDB, which is a huge thing. But so as we've had more enterprise, enterprise level companies interested in MariaDB, we've also added things that they have requested, like security features, like the data address encryption we talked about. We've added more features related to that. We have data masking or data reduction that's come. We have enforced TLS connections to the servers and things like that. Another thing we've never aspired to be like a direct competitor to any other database. We don't want to be match everything Oracle does or SQL Server or anyone. However, there is a benefit of having similar features, because then you can take the skill set. If you have your DBA, you're used to using Oracle and you want to start using MariaDB, then of course if we have similar features, similar query languages, it's a lot easier to do the switch. Not only for the application, existing applications, but for the personnel as well. So we've added more features that people are used to using. So for example, we added common table expressions that we didn't have before, window functions we didn't have before, and some other things like that. Another interesting thing, like decimal. MariaDB used to have a decimal type that was had 30 decimals, but Oracle has 38, right? It's typically who cares, right? But it's a huge thing to go from 38 to 30. You have to do a data conversion, you will lose data and so forth. And it's actually a requirement in finance industry, it's a requirement to have 38. And the requirement originally is based on the fact that Oracle has 38, right? Mm-hmm. But so instead of arguing, we said, well, let's just have 38 and we're done, we don't have to worry about it. So it's like small things like that where we're not trying to copy, but it's just easier. So now we have 38 instead of 30 as our max, for instance. So that's 10.2. This was announced GA a couple of weeks ago, so that's our latest GA release. We're obviously working on our next version as well. So just a couple of things that are likely to come in our next version. The thing I like the most is what I already mentioned. We have something called system version tables. And this is the feature I already mentioned, where you basically, by turning, this is something that you could be able to turn on per table. By turning this on the table, you basically store the history of each row. So this means that you can go back in time and say, hey, what did this row look like in January, for example? And this, you know, there's a lot of potential use cases. A simple one is something like intrusion, like we have an audit plugin, so you can find out everything that happens on the server. So if you have an intrusion, you can see, okay, hey, how did they come in, what did they do? But what you don't see is what data did they get. You can see what queries they ran, but you don't see the results of the queries. However, with the system version tables, you can actually say, all right, well, we ran this query at midnight, January 1st. Now I can use my system version table. I have an ASOF addition to the query language, which is actually an ANSI standard. And then I can say, all right, I want to run this query as of January 1st, midnight. So basically, you get exactly the results the whoever intruded it as well. So for compliance, this function can be very, very useful. It's a very, very powerful thing. I mean, this is just one example of what you can do with it. There's a lot of potential use cases. Some things where you kind of need to create additional tables to keep track of historical changes of your data, like prices and things like that. Well, with this feature, you actually don't have to do it because it's stored in the system already. Another big thing that we've been working on, again, it doesn't have to do with copying things, but it has to do with making it easier, is PLC call. So we actually have we're actually going to have a PLC call parser.
One question about the previous one. So that is associated with a lot of overhead. If you're doing the basically keeping the history of everything, that means that you don't delete data, you only add data and stuff like that. When somebody designs historical tables, they usually take some portion of the data. This is kind of full-blown stuff that historically was not usable.
So the question was about the system version tables. Doesn't this add a lot of overhead? And the answer is yes, it does. So I mean, there's two things, right? So it doesn't add much load to the server, but you will end up using a lot of space to the server. However, again, one of the trends we were showing is the fact that cost of storage is just going down. So it's less of an issue than it was, like, say, 15 years ago. 15 years ago, we designed, again, MySQL cluster, when it came out, it was an in-memory storage only. So it was kind of limited to 4 gigs, and everyone was like, it's only 4 gigs. Now you can have terabytes of RAM, so it's not, and it's the same storage, right? So storage is less of a problem than it used to be. But I mean, you're right, you will add a lot of storage requirements. This is why it's per table, right, first of all? So you only do this on the tables where you need this for some reason. So if you have some transactional tables, there's no need of needing this, if, like, say, you sell something where you don't need to have a system version. So it's only on certain tables, and you can also purge this data, right? So you don't have to store everything all the time. You can purge it as well. Does that kind of answer?
My curious.
Right, so let me continue with the PLC. So basically, this is actually, so the reason why we have it is very interesting. So we have a large bank in Singapore, well, DBS. It's a large bank in Singapore. They came to us and they said, all right, we want to migrate our whatever 100 Oracle servers to MariaDB. Can you help us? We're like, sure. So we were like, well, let's start with the, you know, let's categorize your applications, your servers. Let's start with the easy ones, and, you know, we'll migrate those over, and then eventually go to the harder ones. And they were like, no, we don't want to do that. Let's start with the hard ones. We were like, what? Because that's not the smart way to do it. Because then you're like, well, it might take years. It's going to be painful, and you won't have everything. But they were like, well, if we can show that we can migrate hard ones, then, you know, battle is over, done, we're going to migrate everything. So we were like, okay, so we started looking at, all right, so how do we migrate the hard ones? And they had a lot of PL/SQL, and that was one of the issues. We were like, well, you know, we have stored procedures, but it's not PL/SQL, so all of these will have to be rewritten to the MariaDB stored procedure language. And basically, after these discussions, and we looked at how much effort it would be to rewrite these, someone said, well, what if we just add a parser for PL/SQL? And in the end, we started estimating, well, how much work would that be? And we realized that would be a lot less work of just starting to parse PL/SQL than to migrate all of their stored procedures. So basically, out of that project came this feature that will now go into 10.3. This is by no means a complete PL/SQL parser, but it's enough for DBS. They're actually already using this. They have a 10.2 where they're using this as a. I mean, it's available in our source code, so anyone can try it if you want to use source code. First, there's no alpha yet of 10.3, but it will be available there. But they are already using this. They're testing. They're done testing, and they're going to start using this in production. So that's a pretty cool feature that came out of this kind of collaboration. We'd never have thought of doing it. We would just, because our policy was always, well, you migrate the easy ones, and then probably the hard ones will be end of life by the time we get to them or something. But they did it the hard way, and as a result, everyone benefits by getting these features. Now it's a lot easier to move over. Obviously, you still have to do some application changes and so forth, but this makes it a lot easier. And some other things like, we've already intended to add a lot of JSON support. Again, partially because of the NoSQL push, we realized that, well, there are some things where it makes sense to just store JSON in a database instead of storing, having independent columns for all of it. We already had a feature called dynamic columns in MariaDB, which kind of allows the same thing as storing JSON, except that JSON we store it as text only, and the dynamic columns basically has a type which each of these, so we have a attribute value pair, and each attribute actually has a type, so it's actually a more efficient storage, but it's not the same syntax as for JSON. So we added a lot of JSON features already in 10.2, and we're adding more to 10.3, like native JSON indexing and stuff.
The performance,
yeah. So I mean, it's not. So the, you know, the performance of PL/SQL is not worse than the performance of procedures in our native procedure language, but it's not. I mean, Oracle has a lot of optimizations and things like that which we don't have, right? So it's not going to be as fast as running natively in Oracle.
But this is just performance on parsing, right?
Yes.
You assume it generates some code when you parse, but you don't interpret every condition for every record.
So, what's the question?
I said the slowdown in PL/SQL will just be in parsing once for the procedure, not for every record.
Right. Yeah. I mean, yes. I mean, it's not like, for example, Oracle. You can pre-compile things.
You can't.
So there's a lot of things like that.
What's the release date? 2.3.
So, all right. So, I guess I'll. So, I'm kind of the end of the presentation. So, let's get the question going. So, what's the release? Okay, yes. So, the release date for 10.3. Another question. All right. So, you know, we're transitioning from being being you know, in software, you know, who knows of the Heisenberg uncertainty principle? A couple of guys. So basically, it says that if you know the velocity of a particle, I mean, the more precisely you know the velocity of a particle, the less precisely you know the mass. Same with energy and time. For software, it's about the features and the release date. So the more precisely you know these features in software, the less precise the release date will be, and vice versa. And we're kind of trying to transition from having very precise features and this release date to getting more closer on the release date and more distant features, right? So we're kind of trying to transition to that. So that, having that in mind, our goal is to have a GA early next year. I mean, we're trying to reduce, partly why we're doing this is to, well, partly to have more predictable release dates, but partly also to have a smaller scope, so we don't have like a we haven't had 5 year cycles, but we don't have a 2 year humongous thing where scope creep comes in and then it takes 2.5 years and then it's a huge change. So we want to have more incremental changes and things like that. So our goal is early next year.
So for the columnar storage, are you familiar with Apache Era and Parquet formats?
I'm kind of familiar with it.
Well, I was just kind of curious if MariaDB was looking at using those formats and if there's going to be any interoperability in terms of like that columnar storage, either in memory or on disk.
So I mean, the short answer would be kind of no. There's still a SQL front end, right? And that can change, but we have, for example, in MaxScale, we have a kind of a feature to get data out. So basically, if you insert all the data through MaxScale, MaxScale can also use Avro, basically version of the data, so you can basically transform into other things. And now we're trying to do the opposite with column store, to basically read in Avro data, but it won't be a live feed. The reason, again, for this is because column store is not, being columnar, it's not very good at OLTP, so when you have a lot of inserts and things, it's not as fast, it's not able to keep up to an OLTP system. So for example, if you have an OLTP system, you want to say, okay, I want to store all of this stuff also in my column store so that I can do analytics. Well, it's not able to keep up, so you basically have to somehow basically chunk it into pieces, and using like Avro intermediate is an easy way to do it. So that's going to come up in the next version of column store.
So you mentioned you have the columnar data for analysis.
Mm-hmm.
How hard is it to migrate, like if you have millions of rows of data that you want to transform into columnar data? Is there a tool that you guys have, or is it some script that you write, or?
Yeah, so how hard is it to migrate from like the OLTP to the columnar? And so it's very easy and it can be complicated. So basically you can have both in the same server. So there's like two tables, and in theory you could just do a select and get it from one to the other, but that's not the most efficient way of doing it, because then it will kind of be row by row operations, and the column store is not designed for that, so it's not going to be efficient. So the way we're designing it in the next version is to be able to have like a through Avro, so basically you can get everything through Avro, and then it's up, and then you basically insert it in chunks. But we have a tool for doing very efficient inserts, again, assuming that the data is in chunks. For import, it's called CP import, but that's a tool we use to import data in column store to make it faster, just because like doing the SQL interface, it's not able to keep up with OLTP. So it really depends on your demands, or how much data you have, I guess, or how fast you get data. So the best way is to do it probably in chunks in some form, but depending on how much data you get per day, you can do it fairly easily within the database, or if you have a lot, you might have to use CP import or some other things.
We have time for just one more question, but before we do that, We've got these two beautiful glass with rubber coated bottles to give away. Has everyone who wanted to enter in the contest put their business card in here to win? Because two people will win. Yes, no? I see people. All right, so someone during the time of the next question, you got to put your card in here. I guess pass it around, I don't know. And then we'll take the last question and we'll raffle it off. You need this? Okay.
Yeah.
Is that, by the way, question
I'll still be around, so you, I mean.
Yes, Max will be here for one-on-one questions. All questions will get answered, but not during the main event right now.
So a question about the temporal table. Is this something that you envision for kind of like production analytics, or is this more for ad hoc queries like for compliance? So is this something that can be used to like compare for the same person, analytics on the fly?
Yeah, so that's a good question about the temporal. Can it be used on the fly, or is it more for ad hoc? So it can definitely be used on the fly. The way we're designing it can definitely be used on the fly. Again, there was in the previous question about how much overhead it adds. It was kind of, we alluded to the fact that, well, it does add overhead. So it depends heavily on what kind of system you're having. If it's it's an OLTP where you have high performance demands, you might not be able to kind of do it in the same system. So one of the things, we have a native replication built in MariaDB. One of the things you can do is you can have your master have it turned off, and then have a slave where it's turned on, because all the queries will have the same timestamp and everything when they go to the slave. So if you have it turned on the slave, it will look exactly as it had looked on the master. So you can do things like that. And then you kind of are able to do more sophisticated or more stuff.
Okay, Max will be here for one-on-one questions. We're going to do the raffle in a second. Thank you all for coming, and thank you, Max.